Good morning. I heard rumors that it is just now at least 10 o'clock, if not a little bit after. Welcome to this holy space. Yes, thank you. I'm so used to keeping it on. And thank you for keeping your mask on as we continue to keep each other safe during this pandemic. You have arrived to Williston-Immanuel United Church, and you are either here in-house or you are here at home or wherever you might be streaming today, and we are so glad to see each and every one of you here in this place or in your space. And here at Williston-Immanuel, we believe in acceptance without conditions, affirmation without discrimination. And we want you to know and to remember and to count on that no matter who you are, no matter who you love, no matter your chosen pronoun, no matter the color of your skin or whether you are documented or undocumented, no matter the amount of money you have or you don't have, the education that you have, no matter your afflictions or the mistakes that you have made, you are welcome here at Williston-Immanuel, wherever you are on your journey. And I noticed that we do have people who are visiting with us, and you do not have to name yourself per se, and you don't have to raise your hand, but if you are visiting and you'd like to make yourself known, you are welcome to do it this time. Just to give us a wave, I introduced myself to a couple people. Welcome. And again, I ain't gonna put you on the spot, but I am so grateful, besides having you wave. Welcome, we're so glad that you joined us, and we don't have an official fellowship time, but we have been kind of gathering in small circles of social distancing, getting to know each other. Welcome. We're gonna pull ourselves into this worship space by singing our gathering song, which is Halle, Halle, Halle. It is just one word, so it should be pretty easy to sing to. We are gonna try to clap. I know just saying that might terrify you. We're trying to clap on the two and the four, so follow the congregation. I know. All right, with that said, our theme today is justice. We've been talking about ways in which we can widen the circle. And today we're looking at how we might widen the circle of justice. And with that in mind, I offer you these words to ponder by Dietrich Bonhoeffer. And I want you to kind of ponder these words as we move further into the service and listen to the prelude. And those words are these. We are not to simply bandage the wounds of victims beneath the wheels of injustice. We are to drive a spoke into the wheel itself. Let us ponder these words as we listen to the prelude.
Thank you. let us never forget that God is at work in the world through us, to bring justice to the oppressed, to share food with the hungry, to provide shelter for the homeless, to set all people free. We come this morning to be reminded of God's justice, to be nourished by God's presence, and to find home with God's people. Please join me in the spirit of prayer. Lord, we ask that you move us to choose the right kind of fast, not with ashes, but with actions, not with sackcloth, but in sharing, not in thoughts, but in deeds. Lead us to give up our abundance, to share our food with the hungry, to give up comfort, to provide homes for the destitute, to give up our fashions, to see the naked clothed. With Christ as our example, we will share where others hoard. We will free where others oppress. We will heal where others harm. Then your light will break out on us. Your healing will quickly appear. You will guide us always. Your righteousness will go before us. We will find our joy in you. And we will be like a well-watered garden. We will be called repairers of broken walls. Together, we will feast at your divine banquet table. Amen. And now, you may stand if you are able, and please join us in our hymn, Community of Christ. Please note that we're only singing verses 1 and 2, and you'll find the insert for the music and the words in your bulletin.
Good exercise. We take this time to move into what we call the God box time, and this is an excellent time to maybe explore the scripture in yet another way. And so there's something in this box. Is anyone out there perhaps curious what's in here today? Is there anyone who might like to open the box? Yes.
The box is smaller than it is on my TV screen.
It is much smaller. Aha. It is?
A candle.
Thank you, Bob. Right, so it is a candle. And I'm not quite sure where to stand anymore these days. Okay, good. All right, so what would be some reasons to light a candle?
Worship.
If it's dark.
Power outage.
Yes, power outage, kind of along that same lines as darkness. What else might we light a candle for? To remember someone.
To welcome someone.
To welcome, yes, Maggie, to welcome someone. And I know all you folks online are just eager to share. We're going to work it out some day, so you can share as well.
Special meal.
To show the way. One more answer. Why would we light a candle?
Birthdays.
For birthdays. Yes, especially for people. May I designate the age or just the day? Brenda's turning a year older today. So there was a few answers. Obviously, all of those answers are correct, obviously, and there are more yet. What I was thinking when I put this candle in the God box is that when I light a candle, often it's in prayer, in remembrance of someone, for worship. I think I heard worship somewhere over here. So we do these kind of things for worship, for communicating with God. But you'll find in our text today, it says something a little bit different. And I'm just going to leave it hanging there because we're going to hear that scripture in just a little bit. But more than these rituals of lighting candles, of saying prayers, even gathering together for worship, God is looking for even more. And with that, I'm going to have Paula read our scripture.
Morning scripture reading is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 58, verses 6 through 11, from the New International Version. Is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen, to loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and break every yoke? Is it not to share your food with the hungry, and to provide the poor wanderer the shelter? When you see the naked, to clothe them and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood. Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer your cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am." If you do away with the yoke of oppression, with the pointing finger and malicious talk, and if you spend yourselves in behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness, and your night will become like the noonday. The Lord will guide you as always. He will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land and will strengthen your frame. You will be like a well-watered garden, like a spring whose waters never fail. Here ends today's scripture reading.
Thanks, Paula. The text we just heard takes place after the exile. So people had been, high-powered people actually, had been moved from Jerusalem over to Babylon. And they had been there for about 50 years, and all of those people had returned. But it wasn't as glorious as they had hoped. Persians were now ruling their land. Jerusalem was still in ruins. It had never been rebuilt. There was starvation, and there were power struggles. You see, there was all these tension between those who were in exile coming back to then be in community with those who had been there all this time, the ones who had been left behind. So it was the religious and political leaders, the upper class who were returning and interacting with those who had been left behind, the small landowners and the landless lower class. At the beginning of 58, it seems to be those who have, the exiles who have returned, who are asking for a just decision from God. They're seeking God. They desire to be near God. They're hoping to grab God's attention and win God's favor. Not quite lighting the candle, but that's what they were doing. And they were doing it through fasting, a religious ritual. But God sees through that false humility. That very day that they were fasting, it turns out that they were exploiting their workers. They were quarreling amongst themselves, even throwing fists, it says in scriptures. And in verse 4, God says, you cannot fast as you do today and expect your voice to be heard on high. You see, the fasting was really all about them. Martin Luther took some work of Augustine, St. Augustine, so it was about 1,000 years time of fermiating, and he took this idea of incurvatus in se. It is being curved in on oneself, and both men saw it as a sin. It was a life lived inward for oneself rather than outward for God and others. Kind of catchy, right? Maybe we could put that on a bumper sticker. Incurvatus in se. Being curved inward. You see, for God, it wasn't about the religious ritual. That's not what God wanted. Yes, the fasting was good, but God knew it was just for show. It wasn't acceptable. And so what was acceptable to God? What did God prefer? That's what we hear in the text, to care for one another, to care especially for the vulnerable, to make sure that what they were living in was a just society. They were called on to feed the hungry, shelter the unsheltered, clothe those who were not adequately clothed. They were called on to make themselves available to their family. God was inviting them yet again, inviting God's people into this individual and body of believers, all of them, into a full relationship with God. How? By caring for those in need, by living a right and just relationship with one another. And I love this invitation. It's really God saying, let's widen the circle. My children, I desire more than personal relationship with me. That is all beautiful and wonderful, but I want more than that. Yes, come to me with all your heart, soul, and strength. Love me like that. But you must also be in right relationship with one another. You must love your neighbor as yourself. That's the God. That's the fast that God desires. And that's quite a religious ritual, isn't it? I like to think of it as worship in action. And Jesus would say the same thing, you know, about 500 years later, Jesus would say and teach his listeners and followers of the greatest commandments, right? We remember these. To love God with all our heart, soul, and mind, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. And that tradition has carried down throughout the centuries. It is the same call today. that we are not to curve inward. We are not to have a religious ritual just for the sake of the religious ritual. We must take the worship of God and put it into action, to carry out the fast that God truly seeks, right relationship with others, by caring for and fighting for the other. Now, when I was looking at this text, you might notice that you won't notice yet, you will in just a few seconds notice, what stood out for me was the phrase, provide the poor wanderer with shelter. Did anyone else hear that when it was read? The call to provide shelter. Now, I was all set to go, and I was going to saturate you all with statistics, but I figured the message might get lost in the numbers. So I'm just going to say a few things that you might already know. Both in Maine and in the nation, we are experiencing a housing crisis. Rent is up, I would be willing to say, everywhere. It is certainly up here in the Portland metro area. And the cost of a house, it's incredible what the cost is these days. This is truly a justice issue. In 2020, just last year, to rent a two-bedroom in this area, roughly costing about $1,650, for people in Kennebunk, they would need to work about 18 hours, be paid $18 an hour to be able to rent that. Here in Portland or South Portland, the individual or the family unit would need to earn $31 per hour. And in Cape Elizabeth, $44 an hour, based on the price of the housing. With the end of the federal eviction moratorium that ended in August, it is predicted that evictions will rise. That's already being seen in Knox County. I guess a few counties north of here, evictions have already tripled in that area. With homelessness already on the rise, unaffordable housing and evictions will only drive that higher. And the question is, are we willing to fast? Are we willing to answer God's call out of the mouths of Isaiah to shelter the unsheltered? And yes, there is a lot to tackle. Livable wage needs to be addressed. Affordable housing. Systemic racism. Did you know that here in Maine, although we have only a 1.5% population of people who are African American or Black, and yet the population of those who are homeless is 26%. Something is not right. There are ways to act, certainly. If you've not supported Preble Street, you are welcome to. They're just down and around the corner. They're looking for volunteers because they are still trying to do what they can to feed the homeless. They're always looking for donations of clothing and food, backpacks, tents. There's ways to support Preble Street, whose work has increased, certainly, in this time of pandemic. We can join in solidarity. And perhaps the church needs to put it on our calendar that on the summer solstice, we go to Monument Square and we stand in solidarity with the Homeless Voice for Justice, a group primarily run by homeless people who do a sit out on the summer solstice to bring attention to their plight. You could become active or support, or active and support the Poor People's Campaign. They are doing so much good work around many of these areas, including housing and affordable living and racism. Williston-Immanuel United Church in this particular month supports the Neighbors in Need special mission. We offer seed monies of $100. You are invited to water those seeds with your own donation. This special mission within the United Church of Christ supports ministries of justice and compassion. And this year they happen to be focusing on homeless and immigrant neighbors and communities. So a donation to that would go towards these communities. If you are a landlord, perhaps you could consider not raising your rent. In my own living situation, I've had it raised twice. I've been here 2 years. Is it possible? And I know that property taxes are a lot here, but is it possible to at least not raise it or even lower it for someone who might be living in your rental? This is also really radical, and I realize that, and you can chase me out if you want. When you go to sell your home, have you considered not taking it at the high market value? Selling it for less. Connecting with someone that you know needs a home, but cannot afford it. It's radical, because we're told these things are ours. But what if we did that? What if there was some sort of organization created where people selling homes wanted to be connected with people who really want to live in a house and can't seem to afford it? What if they were connected? I think that would be awesome. As a faith community, what can we do? We have a large space. We have an empty third floor. Is it possible that we convert that to housing? I'd like to find that out. We have a lot of space here to offer. Now you might be sitting there thinking, okay, Pastor, why bother? I don't blame you. That's a lot of work to do, isn't it? It's a lot of hands-on worship. But the answer comes in our text, and I'm going to read it again. God promises the people, listen, if you would just tend to the needs of others, if you would stop curving inward, if you would start looking outward and tending to the needs of those who most need it, that's when your light will break forth. What a spiritual promise that when we're serving others, we're going to be rewarded with this richness in our faith. Healing will quickly appear. When we call on the Lord, God will answer, here I am. That relationship we were longing for all along becomes even tighter, even brighter, even better. And I love the last part. Again, if we are doing away with the yoke of oppression, if we're not pointing fingers at each other and maliciously talking about one another, if we're truly spending ourselves on behalf of the hungry and satisfying the needs of the oppressed, we will be like a well-watered garden. When you're feeling spiritually drained, you just will be well-watered in return. Your people will rebuild the ancient ruins. This part wasn't included in the reading, but the other promise is that things will be rebuilt. You will be called repairers of broken walls, restorers of streets with dwellings. If we turn outward, if we come together as God's people to meet the needs of God's other people, we can begin to rebuild, and we can begin to celebrate a place where there is truly justice for all. I think now is your turn, is it not? Yes, okay, thank you.
We are called as Christians to celebrate all that God has given us by doing our part to give back in the form of our time, talent, and treasure. You are invited at this time to consider the ways that you will give to support the ministries of this church and beyond. Please know that we will not be passing the collection plate, but you are invited to place an offering in the plates located near the doors to the sanctuary as you leave. You can also pay online, and a link can be found on our website. Thank you. Please join me in prayer. God, we long for the time when all who hunger and thirst after justice shall be satisfied. And we believe that, despite the persistence of evil, now is always the time when more good can be done and we can make a difference. May it be so, Lord, through the offering of our gifts and the offering of our lives. Amen.
It is our tradition here at Williston-Immanuel to close in prayer, a way to kind of maybe wrap ourselves up before we go out into the world to serve God. And so we come together in prayer, and I will open with a pastoral prayer. We'll have some time of silence for our own personal prayers that we care to wish lift up. And then we will close with the Lord's Prayer, which I think this Sunday it is in the bulletin, but if you know a different version, you are also welcome to say that version. Let's pray. God of justice and compassion, You who call us to a much different fast than perhaps we even desire. You who call us out from inward looking to outward facing. You who call us to be courageous, to share of what we have with others, to reach out to others who may be different from us, to do everything that we can to meet the needs of those who are most vulnerable. And we thank you, God, that you love us and nurture us when we don't. You love us regardless, and we thank you, for we are a work in progress, to be sure. We ask that you bless us this week. Keep our eyes open. Keep our opportunities there, right before us, to share, whether it is our time, our talent, or our treasure with others. Bless this congregation as we continue to seek ways to serve others. May you move your spirit through this place and help us discern. We look forward, so forward, to seeing you at work in our midst. And we are aware that there are needs, the needs of those who are facing end of life. We lift up Charlie and Sylvia. Charlie, who has decided to continue chemotherapy, we ask blessings upon him as he travels to and from his house. Bless his wife as she awaits for him each time to return. Be with them as they have important conversations. We ask that you be with Lynn Moulton. Lynn, who joins us from Texas each week, and her probable Parkinson's diagnosis. We pray for her and for doctors and all those who will be tending to her in any transitions she experiences. We pray for Kim, foster granddaughter of Brenda and Pat. We pray for her as she prepares for the C-section of twins that she is expecting. She too, with two other children, is experiencing the crunch of housing. And we have so many other people on our minds. We do pray for our neighbors in need. We pray for our own lives and the brokenness we experience. We thank you that you are the God who brings healing. We ask that your healing extend throughout this nation and across the world and all the places that seem so broken and torn. Be that shalom that is so needed. And we ask that you bless us in this time as we hold silence and lift up all those joys and concerns on our own hearts. As we breathe in the Holy Spirit, let us join together in one voice as we pray together the Lord's Prayer, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Before we sing our last hymn, which is actually the first hymn, but it's the last two verses, verses 3 and 4, I want to make just a few announcements. You are welcome to join us for Soul Food. It is our scripture discussion time. We take today's scripture and dive a little deeper and see how it's touching our lives. You're welcome to stay in person here in the building. Or if you want to go home and unmask yourself and get a cup of coffee or tea, you can join us online. So we do a hybrid study of scriptures. You'll find the link on our website under worship, Zoom worship, so you can join us that way. We have an intergenerational worship service next week where we're going to try to bring in all of the senses. Emery Burke will be leading us. She's our Christian Ed facilitator. We do hope that it is kid-friendly, fun, and meaningful. And I hope that you come. We're going to be talking about heritage, kind of thinking about our ancestors, those people who have made a difference in our life, and it might not be a relative, but kind of the past folks in our life that have made meaning for us. I have a very special announcement. Where is she? Oh, I'm looking for Denise.
Denise.
Yes, I am supposed to announce that today is Mark and Denise's 22nd anniversary. Do you have an announcement as well?
I do. Okay. I have a very special announcement. I'm going to do it from here.
I don't know
if
that'll work.
Is this good or should I use yours? So, today is Pastor Appreciation Day. Yeah, and we recently became aware of this, and so we wanted to do something special for you. We are so grateful that, we are so grateful that this year we could do this in person. We've never done this before, and so it's great to do it in person. You brought so much energy, so much light, so much joy to this church. And so we want to acknowledge in a small way the enormous gratitude we have for your ministry and the fact that you are among us as our pastor. Here is a gift card to what I hope is yours and Mike's, one of your favorite restaurants, the Saltwater Grill. I think you've been there before. Okay, and we give it to you so that you may have a wonderful dinner, a truly celebratory time with Mike, and we give it with our thanks and our appreciation.
Thank you so very much.
Thank you.
With that, and truly, thank you so much. With that, just one last thing. We will be continuing conversations about the reconfiguration of the sanctuary, so look for announcements in the Wednesday email regarding that. We'll do them in person here, so look for those so we can continue the conversation. We slowed it down a little bit, but we want to keep ideas brewing and conversations happening. Folks, let us stand and sing together. No, wait, more?
As part of our celebration, I forgot to say this, Matt and Denise have prepared a special musical piece to celebrate you.
Lovely. So I think we're going to go out with this. Thank you. Go with God's peace. Go with that passion to truly fast, to truly connect with others. No, nothing? Oh, okay. To truly connect with others, to build that relationship, to turn outward instead of just inward. Friends, this worship has ended so that our service in God might begin. Go in peace. Amen. Singing that hymn, we're going for broke. It's in your bulletin, verses 3 and 4.